And open with me, if you would, to the book of Romans. So we'd be going through it. And, you know, I guess we all have favorite parts of the book that we like the most. But as I, you know, as I've been looking at it, there's no part that's in vain. You know, Paul didn't just write and to fill space. When he started the letter, sometimes we can look at it and we can go pretty fast through some things. But there's no wasted space in here. He's not vying for space or time. And so it all is profitable. It's profitable for you and me, right? And so that's why we look at it today. I'm just going to cover the first seven verses here today. And we got kind of an introduction last week into it, who the author was and so on. But really the Holy Spirit did. And I'm going to read first seven verses. So Romans chapter 1, verses 1 through 7. Paul, a bondservant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated to the gospel of God, which he promised before through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, concerning his Son Jesus Christ, our Lord, who was born of the seed of David according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. Through him we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among all nations for his name, among whom you also are the called of Christ, of Jesus Christ. To all who are in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. There's something in this and it's inspired by God. So we'll get into it here. But at the beginning, Paul kind of gives three things that he's identifying, especially in this first verse. He identifies, number one, who his master is. And then he goes on to tell his office or the gift that God had given him, and then the purpose to which he was called. So look at those three for a little bit here. But first of all, he says, Paul, a bondservant of Jesus Christ. Some of your versions will just say servant. Some will say slave. And really what it's getting at is a slave. Paul says he called it basically an honor and a privilege. We kind of look derogatory as a slave being a derogatory term. But here, it's a term of whom I belong to. I belong to Jesus Christ. He said, and I'm a bondservant, as another word in my version used, which is proper use of it here, a slave. I'm a surrendered man. Another way of saying it as well. But let me just go to the Old Testament. We don't have to turn there, but say a Hebrew slave was, sometimes you got into trouble, into debt, and you had to pay your debt off to another, say if you were a Jew yourself and to another Jew, and you came under his debt, or you had to work for him, or you became his slave because of something that went wrong in the family or death or whatever, and you had debts, and you were in debt to this other guy. You basically were a slave, but you could only be in Exodus, it explains, for 6 years. In the seventh year, you got to go free. If in that time you could come, if you came with your wife and your family, you left with your wife and your family after that on the seventh year. If the master gave you a wife, then if you chose to leave, you would have to leave without your wife and your children, but he said on the seventh year you could choose, and if you wanted to stay with your master after those 7 years were up, it was voluntary. You did not have to stay. And so here's what he says, and I'm just going to read the two verses from Exodus 21, 5 and 6. But if the servant plainly says, I love my master. Yeah. I love my master. I love my wife. My children. I will not go out free. Then his master shall bring him to the judges, and he shall also bring him to the door, to the doorpost, and his master shall pierce his ear with an awl, and he shall serve him forever. See, this is a bondservant, somebody who says at the end of his 6 and 7 years, he fell in love with his master. I love my master. I'm a willing slave of his. I love my wife. I love my children. And so then he would take him before the judges to make it public, to make it, you know, confirm it. They'd take him to the doorpost. Girls, if you want your ears pierced, here's a way to do it. They did it back then. They'd take your ear next to the doorpost like this, take an awl there and take a hammer and put a little hole in your ear. probably a little bigger. I mean, I've seen guys are wrestling with quite some big, big holes in their ears now. I don't understand it. It's more to grab, but anyway, I think it's a disadvantage. But look, everybody that would look at you after that experience with the y'all and before the judge, everybody that looked at you in town or even that knew about this would say, this is the property of another man. This man belongs to somebody. And his ear proved it. Every time you looked at that man, you could say, he belongs to so-and-so. And that's what Paul is saying. My ears are pierced. I belong. I'm a slave, a bond slave of the Lord Jesus Christ. And what a thing. I mean, I don't know if you guys have been around wrestling enough, but I have my whole life. And I thank God my ears are, they're not the same as they used to be, but they're semi-ear, we call it in wrestling world, cauliflowered ears. You ever seen that? You ever seen cauliflowered ears? Most people that have cauliflowered ears and it just fills in here and it gets hard and you can't change it. Sometimes it sticks out here in the middle a lot. Anyway, if you've ever seen it, you look at somebody, when I go to, not even in a tournament, sometimes I'll be in the airplane, I see somebody's ears like that. I don't have to ask what he did. Usually it's, are you a wrestler? Yeah, how do you know? No. Usually his ears give it away. And so in a similar way here, your ears would give you away in this sense that you belong. But Paul's main point is to, I belong to somebody else. He's identifying who his master is. I belong to the Lord Jesus Christ. And he's identifying again who his master is. I'm a willing slave. I chose. He says in 1 Corinthians 7:23, Paul says, you were bought at a price. Do not become the slaves of men. You're bought with a price. So who you have one to please. Don't become the slave of the men. After you're already a bondservant of the Lord Jesus Christ, you serve him. You don't serve men. And he says a similar thing in Galatians 1:10 where he says, for do I now persuade men or God? Or do I seek to please men? For if I still pleased men, I would not be a bondservant of Christ. You see? He said, if I care about now is pleasing people, trying to please people, he said, then I would no longer be really qualified to be called myself a bondservant of Christ. And I think what he's saying here too, and what I hope that the church is as a group, as a whole, that we're people who are bent on pleasing Christ. That ought to be like Paul. I belong to Jesus Christ. He's my master. I'm his willing slave. I belong to Jesus Christ. I've been bought at a price. And Peter says that I've been purchased with precious blood. He didn't just say blood, but he said precious blood. The blood of my master. My life is no longer my own. Now I live for the one who died for me and rose again. I'm completely at his disposal. Can you say like Paul, I love my master. I love him. I'll serve him forever. That's at the end of Exodus, said, I will serve him forever. And Paul is basically saying the same thing. My master is Christ Jesus. He asks the question, who's your master? Who are you a slave to? You're a slave to somebody. The worst kind of slavery is sin, and Paul will get into that later. But we all serve somebody. Jesus said you can't serve God and money. Either money masters you or you master it. But you cannot serve both, two masters, only one. So Paul basically stayed in the first part there. Paul, a bondservant of Jesus Christ. I belong to him. He's my master. And then secondly, he says what his office is, what his title really is. And he says, I'm called to be an apostle. I'm a called apostle. Again, it's not something Paul chose. Paul didn't say, I think I'm going to be an apostle. He said, God called him to that. God called him to that ministry, a sent one, a messenger, right? Is what it means. And he had the authority of one. God had saved him, called him, and sent by God with a message. Okay? Isn't it neat? He has a message to declare. So that's his office. Thirdly, his purpose, he says right here in the first verse, separated to the gospel of God. Some of your verses set apart for the gospel. It's not It's not so important that we're what we're separated from, in a sense. You know, I'm going to try to explain this. It's not the real important thing that I'm separated from certain things. Paul was a Pharisee, and the word almost itself meant separation, separated, a separated one. And if you read the what the Pharisees did and believe, I mean, you just read the New Testament too, they were separated from just about everything. They were separated from other priests who didn't believe like they did. They separated themselves from the common people, from the Gentiles, or Jews who became Hellenistic Jews or whatever, the Jewish Greek culture and so on. But what about, they accused Jesus of sitting with sinners. They refused to sit and eat with sinners lest they pollute themselves. You could look at a Pharisee, though, and you would say, there's a morally upright person. He's set apart. You say, that's good, isn't it? By itself, it's not. You can't, just that alone is not enough. Philippians 3, 5 and 6, Paul tells about his past life as a Pharisee. He says, I was a Hebrew of the Hebrews. I mean, it doesn't, he's trying to put superlatives here on everything. I'm a Hebrew of the Hebrews, he says, a Pharisee. And he said concerning in Philippians 5, 3, verses 5 and 6, he says, concerning the righteousness which is in the law, blameless. You couldn't look at the law really in Paul's life and say he had any blame. Paul said, I was blameless in this word. So you can be separated. And he was separated. He was a Pharisee. But all you can have all this separation without Christ. And Paul definitely had that. He didn't have Christ, but he was separated into his religion or whatever, but then he persecuted the church. And Paul, when he was arrested by Jesus Christ on the road to Damascus, the first words were, Paul, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? He was separate, all right, but not to God. And so somebody said, I don't smoke, I don't chew, and I don't go out with girls who do. And somehow he went on to say, well, neither does a fence post. And so you got the religion of a fence post. If that's all your religion is that I don't smoke and I don't chew and I don't go with girls who do. You got the religion of any post on Hans's farm there. See, quitting these things won't make you more like Christ in a sense. What it amounts to of separation without Christ and so on is, or you say to yourself, well, I don't do this and this and this. And I heard this a lot in different places. Well, I don't do this and this and this. I'm not a good Christian, but at least I don't do this and this and this. And they go on and give a list of things. But you can say all that and be nothing more than a proud, bitter Pharisee like Saul. He was proud and bitter. And that's what Paul was before he met the Lord Jesus. And so he'd already been separated from something. But here his point is there. Paul had been separated to something positive. Not just from something. And a Christian ought to be somebody who is separated. I'm not knocking that part. But you also have to be separated to something, for something. And Paul says, I'm separated for the gospel. What's my purpose in life? What's this ministry that God has given me as an apostle? It's to be, I've been separated, set apart. Now from the old life I lived, now I'm separate apart for one thing, for the gospel of God. That's my mission in this world. He's letting them know right off the bat. And obviously Paul's life was radically changed, wasn't he, after this? Radically changed. A different person by the gospel. And notice here he calls it the gospel of God. Gospel of God. It didn't originate with Paul. That's what he's saying too. I didn't come up with this message. I didn't make this gospel up. In Galatians 1:12 he said, for I neither received it from man, nor was I taught it, but it came to me through a revelation of Jesus Christ. Where did Paul get it? He met Jesus Christ face to face on the road to Damascus. And he said, I wasn't taught this gospel. I didn't receive it from a man. Nor was I taught it. But he says it came through the revelation of Jesus Christ. And so he says it's God's. And it didn't originate with Catholics. The gospel didn't originate with Martin Luther, or the Protestants, or the Baptists, or the Charismatics, or the Presbyterians, or the, name it. It didn't originate with anybody. It originated with God himself. And that's important to know. And the subject of the book is the gospel. And what's the gospel mean? Any of you kids can tell me? Gospel means faith. It includes faith. Good news. That's it. Remember that song we do downstairs too? G-O-S-P-E-L spells good news. Right? Does that hit it right? Two might not be right, but it means good news. And that's what the book is about. It brings good news. And yet Paul says in Galatians 1:8, but if we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel to you than what you have that was preached to you, let him be accursed. There is one gospel, and it belongs to God. But Paul is also aware that what he's teaching is the gospel of God, and so we ought not to tamper with his gospel. You know what I mean? I had some people, Jehovah's Witnesses, come to the door yesterday, and they bring me a different gospel. It's not good news. It comes in the form of good news, and they'll use a Bible. And so this is what I'm saying. Don't tamper with the gospel. Galatians 1:6-7, listen to this. Paul says, I marvel that you Galatians, are turning away so soon from him who called you in the grace of Christ to a different gospel. One of works. Paul says, I'm surprised at you. You're turning to a different gospel, which is not another. But there are some who trouble you and want to pervert the gospel of Christ. Pervert the gospel. See, it's possible to take the gospel of God and to pervert it. And so he's warning the Galatians that they were turning to a different gospel, which was not another gospel. But there are some who trouble you and want to pervert the gospel of Christ. He's meaning there's a false gospel, which brings false conversion as well. But you know the neat thing about this? Okay, God planned the gospel. This is God's gospel. You know what the neat thing about it is? That it's a planned gospel. It's been around, and God planned it. As you read the Old Testament, first look at the verses, verse 2 with me, which he promised before through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures. This wasn't some new thing that started with Paul. Okay, that's what he's getting at too. Paul said, you know, I received the gospel. It's my job. God, I've been separated to the gospel of God. This is what I preach. But this thing didn't start with me. It's come, he says here, which God promised before through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures. Way back here in the prophets and the Old Testament, God had promised that there was a gospel coming, as it were. And he talks about it here. So it starts with God. He has a word he wants to tell us. Isn't that neat? God promised some things. And you read through the Bible, God promises us things. And God wants to speak to us. A neat thing. But why God would communicate with us. And he did it through the prophets. And what did they do with it? It gets deposited into the scripture, into the Bible, into these writings. That we now call, Paul calls them holy scriptures. You know, on your Bible it say holy Bible. And Paul says these are holy scriptures. Holy words, ancient words, ever true. Changing you and changing me. Neatest thing, he calls them holy here because they're unique, they're pure, they're holy. Because they come from God. And so this is a holy book in that sense. And so it was directed to you and to me as well. So Christianity, you see, isn't a new religion or something. It's a fulfillment of something God started long ago. And then what does it say next? Concerning his son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The focus of the gospel is a person. The focus of the gospel. Never forget that, would you? The gospel is about Jesus Christ. It's not a list of rules and that type of thing. John 5:39, Jesus is speaking. He said, "You search the scriptures, for in them you think that you have eternal life, and these are they which testify of me." Jesus said, I mean, the New Testament hadn't been written yet, so he's speaking of the Old Testament. He says, "These are they which testify of me." Just read this book. And what is it all about? It talks about a person. It's about Jesus. It's about him. And so Christianity is not a creed. Mr. Crown, if you've been around here long enough, you'll recite the Apostles' Creed. "I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth." And you heard him go through it before. And those are good things. Those are, you know, creeds that, especially if you didn't have the written word, you would memorize them. There were things said throughout. There have been many creeds and stuff. And they're good and they're helpful to remind us of Scripture, especially when you didn't have it in writing and stuff. You could go home with something you memorize and know about it. But that's not what, that doesn't make you a Christian because you can quote a creed. It's a person. It comes down. It's not a code or a cause. It's Christ. And so you take Christ out of the gospel, and what do you have? It's like having a well without water, right? Music without notes. Or numbers without mathematics. I mean, mathematics without numbers. That's what you have when you take Christ out of the gospel. You're left with nothing. It's no longer good news. And so Paul is saying the source of the gospel is God. And the subject of the gospel is Jesus Christ. Okay, and let's remember that. Never get away from that. When we're telling people the gospel and we're letting them know their sinners and so on, you have to tell them about Jesus. It's Jesus is the one the Holy Spirit will magnify his work. And so Jesus came, even when he came preaching, he said, preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God when he was in Galilee. And saying that the time is fulfilled, the kingdom of God is at hand, repent and believe the gospel, Jesus said. The time is at hand. And Jesus himself preached the gospel of the kingdom. And he said, repent and believe it. Believe it. Believe the gospel. And then he explains more. Here in verse 3, he says he's born of the seed of David according to the flesh. Now he says, this gospel is about a person named Jesus Christ. Okay, and who is he? He is one who was born of the seed of David according to the flesh. In other words, he was a descendant of David with rights to the throne. And to prove that this is Messiah, this is he. He's a descendant of David. In other words, this is two explaining his humanity. And then now you see his deity in verse 4. And declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. Here you see his absolute deity. See, God is the God-man. And when he talks about the power, it's quite some power, wouldn't you say? Because he walked out of that grave. Jesus died and was buried. And on the third day, he rose again. That's power. That's power to raise the dead. I mean, it's power to create the world, but raise the dead. Incredible. And I think he shows that, you know, in death sometimes with people has the idea and conjures up all kinds of things and the witch at Endor and so on, bringing up the dead and so on. So there's some dirty dealings and mediums that deal with death and so on. And Paul's setting that aside. He says, listen, what happened on the here when Jesus was raised from the dead, it was by the Spirit of holiness. Had nothing to do with dirty magic or anything like you might think of raising somebody from the dead. It was according to the Spirit of holiness. And the one who Jesus himself was holy, right? He never sinned. Imagine that. Somebody was telling, we were listening to somebody preach with the family, and they talk, imagine if you were Jesus' brothers. You know, he was always perfect. You know, being in a home where he'd always did the right thing, always said the right thing. But John Phillips here says about Jesus, now if I can read it here, he never uttered hasty, unkind, untrue, or frivolous word. He was never never entertained impure thoughts. His actions never debased for selfish ends. His influence, never bad. His judgment, never wrong. He never had had to apologize for anything he did or said, or to retract a single word he's spoken. He's never too late or too early, and so on. He has absolute victory from the moment he drew his first breath in that Bethlehem barn until the moment he closed his eyes in death on that cross of Calvary. He never had to apologize. Everything he said was true. This is the one. He was pure according to the Spirit of holiness. He was raised with power from the dead. He's God, the God-man. And then verse 5. Through him we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among all nations for his name. This is really almost, this verse by itself is a miniature of the book of Romans. Through Jesus we have received grace. God's unmerited favor towards us that we don't deserve. See that? Through Jesus, through him that was raised from the dead, we have received grace and apostleship. In other words, Paul on his way to Damascus received his calling. He was saved by the grace of God. What was Paul doing to earn God's favor at that time? He was killing Christians. He was persecuting Jesus. And you could see it was just the grace of God. God reached down one day and called Paul. Saul of Tarsus, and arrested him there, and then gave him the call to be an apostle. And you know what? It takes the grace of God rested upon him. It wasn't a once, and then he didn't need God's grace anymore. We need the grace of God rested upon him from that day on, every day of his ministry, and same with you and me. The grace of God is something that keeps us day by day in the ministry ever since then. First day we received it. And again, it wasn't according to his goodness, for there was none in Paul, Saul at that time, or you and I, that could God cause God to look at us and say, he's worthy of it. But the result of this grace through the gift that Paul had received through the apostleship, it had a purpose, you see, it had a result, it had a goal. And what was that? Obedience to the faith. Obedience to the faith. What's the use of having all this gospel if at the end of it we don't obey the truth of it? Like Jesus said. I think that's what Jesus was saying. He preached the kingdom of God. And then he commanded men to repent and to believe the gospel. It's something not just to be heard and know up in our head. What's good does it do us? To go to church to know these things in our head and yet not be obedient to these things. And Jesus said, if you heard the gospel, two things you need to do. Repent. And believe. Believe the gospel. And that's the result. That's what he aimed for. And it has effect. Boy, Paul had received this grace through Jesus. And his calling was through Christ. And he goes out and he preaches. Guess what? He ends up in a jail. A jailer comes to faith in Christ. Almost committed suicide that night. Almost left, again, a mother widowed, a widow. And children without a father. That night, but the grace of God came to that man through Paul and Silas, right? As they preach, and he says, man, he falls before the prisoners, and the jailer falls before the prisoners on his knees and said, what must I do to be saved? Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you and your household will be saved. And it says there was rejoicing in that home that night. See, it changes life. What good would it have been for the jailer to hear those things, but never affect his life? The Ethiopian eunuch, too. Philip told to go out to the desert. The Spirit of God spoke to him. Go out to the desert. And there was revival, good things going on where he was in Antioch. And yet he obeyed the Spirit of God. We need to obey if the Spirit of God is speaking us to his brothers and sisters, telling us to do something. He still speaks, you know. You go out, he goes out to that road. What's he find? A treasurer from Ethiopia going through the country in his chariot. And then he's reading something, and God tells him, that's the one I want you to go talk to. And so here goes Philip running up to the chariot. I don't know, the guy must have, if you were there and had bodyguards like you might have had, you don't know what's going to happen. But he climbs up in there with him, shares the gospel with him. In the end, the guy says, well, what hinders me from being baptized? And He gets down in the water, he baptized, and his life was totally transformed. He says he went on his way rejoicing. That's what I like about this good news. See, it's good news. If people go away from it rejoicing, it's good news, and it had an effect on their life. They believed it. They obeyed the truth that they received. You see that? There, it's something not just to believe in your head. It's something you actually, it does come to the heart, but then you put it out into practice and you obey it. It comes a part about obeying the gospel. And so here, the obedience to the faith. And it says it's among all nations, all the nations. See, God never excludes anybody. He doesn't care what the ethnic background is or anything like that. God cares for each people. It's for all the nations. It's going to have an effect on all the nations. You read in the book of Revelations, I think it was chapter 7, where there's a number before the throne of God that nobody can number. And it says they're from every nation, every tongue. That gets me excited. And then when Jesus said to go into all the world and preach the gospel to all the nations, it shows to me that one day there's the fulfillment of it in heaven. We haven't reached it yet, and so we need to keep doing it. You see, the perspective that Paul has is might be different than ours. I heard this illustration this week. Somebody was building in a big city somewhere. They were doing some construction. Somebody's doing something with chiseling some concrete. And so some guy curious walking by, he just thought he caught his attention and said, "Hey, what are you doing there?" to one of the workers. Worker just turned around. I'm chiseling stone. Cement. I'm just chiseling here. Now, he wasn't satisfied with that answer. I think he wanted something more. And so he says to the next guy, he says, "What are you guys doing there?" He says, "Oh, I'm bringing a paycheck home every week. That's what I'm doing out here. I'm chiseling away here." And the third finally gives him an answer, and he stands up, stops his work, and he says, "I'm building a great cathedral." And that satisfied the answer of the man. He had the right vision, didn't he? All the things the other guys were said is true. "I'm chiseling here. I'm just bringing home a paycheck." But imagine the third man. He had his heart into it. His heart was into it, and he's saying, "I'm building a great cathedral. I'm looking towards the end." And you know what? I think that the gospel is the same way. What do you do? If somebody asks you, "What's your gift? What do you do?" "Well, I clean the church. I teach Sunday school." And those things might be true, and it's true. But you see, the picture is much bigger than that, isn't it, brothers and sisters? Jesus Christ saved me so that I can build up the body of Christ, and every single one of you is for that purpose that are saved. It's for the upbuilding of the body of Christ. And what? And to take this gospel into the ends of the earth. You see, Paul's vision, it wasn't, "I'm a slave of Jesus Christ, and then we'll just start here." He said, "I belong to somebody." Not only that, man, I'm imparting something that changes lives. It changed me, changing me and changing you, these ancient words. It's been around forever, and God's revealed it to us. And he says, and there's going to be some that are obedient to the faith. And it's going to be among all the nations. And so we need to carry it to all the nations. We need to tell about it to our neighbors and to our friends. For his name's sake. That's the reason. For the Swanton Christian Church's sake? No. For the pastor's sake? No. For the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, for his glory, for his honor. It all brings praise to him. And that's what people, when they look at your life, ought to see that the banner, as it were, that you belong to Jesus Christ. And that it's for his sake that you're doing that. The ultimate goal of all God's dealings with us is that his name of Christ would be exalted in your life, in your job, in your family, among your friends. That's it. I exist ultimately that the name of Christ would be exalted in my life. All for Jesus, all for Jesus. And then the sixth verse. Among whom, he just talked about all nations, and it says, among whom also you are the called of Jesus Christ. Man, it even reached Rome. The gospel even reached you guys way up there. It's for all nations, and Rome, you're getting it. The gospel is changing people in Rome, even in Italy, And this gospel is going to continue to go, and he's calling a people from all nations. And Paul always tried to go where people were never, and you would see that by the end of chapter 15 or 16. He said he wanted to go where the gospel hadn't been preached yet. Why did he go there? Because he knew there was a promise in God's words, and he quotes it, that those who have never heard will hear and believe. And I encourage you, you meet somebody who's never heard, and their chances are they're going to believe because there's a promise that some from that nation are going to believe. And so you find somebody from another nation, tell them about Jesus. Tell them the gospel. They might believe. It's among whom also you are the called. Again, who does it? Jesus Christ. God's calling people. And verse 7. To all those who are in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. To all who are in Rome, loved. Some of your versions will just say loved. That's what it means. Loved by God. Think, did you ever stop to think? We sing that song, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. I remember the first time I heard an African preach on that when I was in Macedonia. He got so excited when he said why he was waiting for a visa in an embassy. I still remember the story behind it, to come to Macedonia. And he was in Africa. I can't remember the country right now. But anyway, he was a poor guy. Visas weren't given out very lightly. And he says people push their way to the front. You force yourself into that building. You force your papers up there because it's chaos. And if you just sit back, you'll never get a visa. And so he came in there thinking, and he watched for a long time. And he was getting discouraged, and he wasn't being pushy and stuff. And he was sitting there with his paperwork. And I remember him telling, he says, as I was sitting there in my place, I remembered the song, Jesus loves me. This I know. I think that's what Paul's saying here. It excited this guy, and I remember when he talked about it. Do you get it? Does that lost its wonder to you? That God loves you, especially if you're a Christian. My goodness, he's lavished us. And so he says, you who are in Swan, loved by God, called to be saints, means Christians, a holy people, set apart to God. That's all it is. You and I have been set apart. But isn't that wonderful to know that God loves me? I don't know what you're going through now, but if you're having a hard time, to know that God loves me is an awesome thing. God loves me. And here God is telling Paul is letting the Romans know that. Loved by God, called to be saints. And he gives us greeting here. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. It's an awesome thing to have grace and peace, isn't it? And where they come from, these things, can only come to us from God. And so, think of that, you're loved by God. We're just a speck here, aren't we? And the world is big. And here's a tiny rabbi writing a tiny letter to a tiny group of Christians in Rome. And we're just a small group here today, a speck in a big world. President Trump doesn't even know we're here. But God does. God knows we're here. And yet God called us into his service. Isn't that awesome? Think of that. God loves you and has called you to be one of his own. And he says about us, the church, right? That's people. That the gates of hell will not prevail against it. We can be small in Rome, and Rome can be killing Christians, but the gates of hell will not prevail against the church. He says, I'll build my church. And we get to be a part of that. So don't measure significance by size, right? The stone, if you wanted to think of that, the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. Builders should know which stone is the best to put in a building, no? He says that the stone which the builders rejected, that's Jesus. He's become the chief cornerstone. This is marvelous in our eyes, he says. This is the Lord's doing, and it's marvelous. God does things with small groups of people. He can do great and awesome things through one person. who's totally sold out to Him, whose master is Jesus Christ. Who's your master this morning? Do you know it? If you don't know Him, you're called to obedience, to obey the gospel. And it'll change your life. Some people don't want it, and God doesn't force it. Jesus said, that they wouldn't come to Him, that they might have life. He says, I'm offering you life. He says, but they won't come to Me that they might have life. They won't. They're unwilling. But the offer is out there. And it's out here this morning. And if you're a Christian, God be encouraged this morning that what you have is an eternal gospel. It didn't start with you, and we don't teach it to you as though it originated with us. It was prophesied years ago in the Holy Scriptures. And it's changing lives as the gospel goes out, as the message is spoken. And God's going to use people. He's going to use kids. He's already using kids. Hans told me a story this morning, just how God is using the children and how they know right from wrong and know the gospel, know the truth. And it's going to change lives. But we have to be obedient to it. Amen? It's something to be obeyed. Repent and believe. Let's pray. Father, we thank You for Your words here this morning. We thank You that our God, the God of the Apostle Paul and of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, James and Elijah and all of these people in God, bygone years, that You are also our God. They aren't any more special than anyone here. They had a nature like ours. And I thank You, Lord, for placing Your love upon us. Undeserving as it is, I thank You for Your grace this morning and Your apostleship. Whatever Your gifts and callings You're giving to different ones in the group, it's going to be different for each one of us. But may we use them, Lord, to the upbuilding of the church, the body of Christ, to build them up. And also, Lord, to see this gospel go out into all nations, that it might be obeyed. There might be many, Lord, that obey the truth. We ask that You would do this in Your mighty name for Your sake, Lord. It's for Your name's sake. We ask that this would be continue to speak to us through the book of Romans, Lord. We thank You for this book. We thank You that it's not just meant for people way back when, but for us today. Lord, help us. Help us to believe. And Lord, may it set us on fire. And I pray that the gospel will go out here from Swan to the surrounding areas in Addison County and out into all the world, Lord, as You intended it to do. Help us not to keep it to ourselves. And thank You, Jesus, that for many of us here this morning, we can say our master is none other than the Lord Jesus Christ Himself. Thank You, Lord, for that privilege of belonging to You. And I ask that You bless this week and all that we do and say for Jesus' sake. Amen. 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 Well, God bless you all. Have a great week as you serve Him. And again, next week we'll take the next few verses, I think maybe through verse 15 or so. So if you want to read ahead and study ahead, that's great. All right. God bless you.